So we're going to start off with some questions. The series is called Family Matters. We asked you all to write in questions, and you all did that to an abundant number, and we appreciate that. I probably won't be able to get to every one of them. So here's question number one as we start off. And by the way, my friend's up here today, for those who didn't notice, and she, amen, right? Didn't want to not introduce her. What's your name? No, just teasing. All right, here's the question. We are a couple that were saved at Faith Family and been attending for several years now. One of the most appealing things about Faith Family is the importance that Pastor Mike and Barb put on the next generation and how they empower younger pastors, which lead a great environment for our children. And thank you for saying that. We appreciate it. Pastor Jordan does a great job, and my wife and I believe in him tremendously. We serve every other weekend and attend most weekends. Our children always come with us. However, sometimes, this is the question, it seems we just drop them off to class, but they don't come away with church friends. How would you recommend that we try to get our 8-year-old more engaged to build friendships within the church?
Great question. And because we saw the same thing you're seeing as parents, in January, we launched Connect groups for kids. And because we know it's hard for them to come out during the week and different times, we actually do it during service. So the kids are experiencing praise and worship and the time that they used to experience. And then afterwards, they break up into connect groups, which is so wonderful. So the kids are at a table with other kids their age and their gender, and they're with consistently the same leader. So they're getting to know the other kids at their table. They're also getting to know their leader. And then they walk them through what they had learned and how they can apply that in their life and let the kids talk with each other about those things. And it's been really healthy so far. It's pretty new, but so far so good. So we are trying to emphasize that in the children's ministry. But also something to keep in mind, camp has always been another great opportunity. The kids are together for a much greater length of time. We only have your kids just, you know, a couple hours a week if you come twice a week, you know. So camp is a big deal with that. Pastor Jordan told us that in the 10 years that he's been involved in camp, he's yet to see anything that helps to start establish those strong, lengthy relationships between the kids. Beyond that, you do have a part to play as a parent, as you well know. We really encourage you, get to know some of the parents in the church of kids that have kids your age, and reach out. Set up play dates with them. You know, go to the park, go grab a coffee and let the kids play. You can do some things to enhance that. And then beyond that, have your kids bring kids they know. So, you know, they've got kids they go to school with. What we do is we reach people, we reach children, we reach kids who are far from God. So have them, go pick them up, you know, start a relationship with the family of those kids at school and bring them here. So not only are they building those strong relationships here at church, but they're building strong relationships with kids at school that hopefully they'll come and give their lives to Christ.
Great answer. Second question was this: I am divorced and remarried, with this being my husband's first marriage. We were both born again believers when we married. What does this mean regarding our salvation, as the word tells us that not only are we committing adultery, but I am responsible for my husband's sin in this matter. Please help. I can't imagine how whoever wrote this in, how you feel. This, you know, this is really what you're feeling. Because I want to share something I believe that will help everyone in this church today. We don't want to run out and get divorced, as you understand God's against divorce. But let me just tell you this. If the grace of God is not big enough to forgive someone who's gotten a divorce, come on, then this whole gospel is sort of a joke. And I know you might say, well, yeah, but Jesus said this. Jesus was referring and talking to people under the old covenant. And he was referring to people that had to live still under that covenant. He wasn't talking to the church. He wasn't talking to the people that Paul talked to. So listen to this. This is in the Bible in 1 Corinthians 7, 27, 28. Listen to what it says. Amplified Bible says, are you bound to a wife? That means, are you married? Do not seek to be free. In other words, we shouldn't be seeking to get a divorce, but it happens. We understand that in the world we live in. He said, are you free from a wife? Do not seek a wife. But watch what he says. But if you do marry, in other words, you've been divorced and you do marry, you have not sinned in doing so. Come on. All right. Yeah, you guys really got quiet. Like, well, that's not in the Bible. No, that's in the Bible. And I want you to know that I know some great pastors and ministers that are Greek scholars. And in the Greek language, it literally says, if those who have divorced, remarried, they have not sinned. So if you divorce and you are remarried, you have not caused your husband to sin or your wife. You are not in sin every day you wake up. What a cloud to live under that you think, my gosh, I'm in sin and I'm causing him to sin. My life would be miserable if I had to wake up to that every day. Let me set you free today. You are not sinning if you've been remarried and God still loves you tremendously. Amen? So hey, listen. We're hoping these questions and answers help you, but we got to get right in what we're going to talk about. So we believe in families. It's like one of the main things we believe in our church. When we renamed our church from the name it used to be and named it to Faith Family Church, family is in there for a reason. We believe in families and we want to help you grow. So this weekend, we're going to talk about something that you could really check out immediately, depending whether or not where you're at in life, all right? So we're going to talk about parenting. So you'd be like, I'm done. I don't need to hear about parenting. My kids are older. Well, my kids are all older, and they're here today in church, but they have kids. And I know for me in teaching this, I want to help my grandkids as much as I can. I still want to help my kids as much as I can. And you should want to do the same for yours. So what we're going to talk about, to me, you can, some of the principles we're about to talk about right now, you can apply these in every area of life. So here's a question I want you to ask yourself. I want you to think about this. You might want to jot this down. Here's a question for you. Are you raising your kids to be adults? Or are you just raising them to be kids for the rest of their life? Are you raising them to be adults? Now listen, there's 1,000 things Pastor Barb and I could have talked about this morning about kids and raising kids. We decided we want to go ahead and teach on how you can make your kids successful, functional children that grow into functional, successful adults. We believe that's more important than anything, that you know how to do that. Now listen, Psalm 127:3 says, children are a gift from the Lord. They are a real blessing. And so we know kids are a blessing, they're a gift, they're all these great things. How many know if you're a parent, there are times it doesn't feel like that? It's like, no, they are not a gift right now, right? I mean, all of us go through that at difficult times, you know. But here's some things that we want to talk about first today. And if you're taking notes, you might want to jot some of this down today. We really encourage you to do that. There are some things that we need to be aware of as parents when we're parenting our kids. Now, we told you this last week, but I just want to reiterate it real quickly. We've been married, it'll be 35 years in April. Our children are both grown and both go to church here at Faith Family, both involved. And I believe it's so important for you to understand, we do not think because we've been married this long or because our kids go to church, we got it all together. There were times that our kids were not like they are right now. They had challenges in their life. And you have to do your best as a parent. And that's the encouragement. But on the way, on the path, on traveling down this path, here's some things you need to be aware of. Number one, we can allow our kids to become more important than God if we don't watch out. Listen, the Bible says in Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God. And I just know this. If your kids see God secondary in your life, when they grow up, they're going to say, God doesn't need to be first in my life. He was secondary in my mom and dad's life. And I sure appreciate some of the people in our church. I see people here today. They're people, high-level, high-functioning people that own businesses. They've got a life that is really going on. But they put Jesus Christ first. They put church first. They bring their kids to church. I think if you understand, you do that, your kids are going to grow up knowing, my mom and dad put Jesus first. I'm going to do the same thing. You're modeling it for them when they watch you do that. Second thing is, we can allow them to be more important than our marriage is. Guys, listen, one of the worst things you can do is all of a sudden your kids hijack your marriage. Are y'all out there? Your kids are wonderful. They're awesome. And we know when they're little, it's like, oh my gosh, you know, they're so great. Yeah. But listen, they can hijack your marriage the day they're born all the way until they graduate. And when they're done graduating and there's no kids in the house anymore, you're going to look at each other and say, who are you? Come on, they hijacked your marriage. Listen, we love our kids. We love them, but don't let them mess up the marriage you have with the person that God puts you with. You need to keep that first place, right? And then, I'm going quickly because we have a lot to cover. Number three, we can allow them to be more important than our budget. And I know this one, it's like, wah, wah, wah. It's like, I don't want to hear about our kids can be more important than our budget. But the truth of the matter is this. When your kids all of a sudden become so more important than God does, and then all of a sudden you think, I've got to get him this, I've got to get him that. And you all know this, right? There can be a competitive trap with other people in parenting. Well, these kids have this, and these parents get them this, and these, they go on this vacation, you know. It's like, hey, you know, my friends are going to Paris, and their kids are going to Paris, and you're like, well, we're driving down to Paris, Ohio, down here with our kids this summer. It's like, well, there's a real great vacation, right? So it can be just a bummer, right? And so I think one of the most important things is not to let your budget get hijacked the same way that your marriage can, and all of a sudden your kids take over and you have no money, and it's like, I'm spending money I don't have, but I want my kids to be competitive with other kids. Listen, just love them. Let me just tell you this. There are kids that aren't ever gonna get the kind of love that you give your kids. Love them above everything. One of the most important things to do. Amen? All right, so I'm gonna pull my wife into this. Let's talk about keys to raising your children. And if you're taking notes, this is the part. If you're like, I didn't take anything with Pastor Mike, take the notes here with what she's about to cover. So we're going to talk about how do you raise these kids successful and functional. Let's talk about this first one.
Okay, so our first point is this: create non-negotiables. And as we go through this, if you think about it, your kids are going to experience non-negotiables in every aspect of their life. When they go to school, there are certain non-negotiables. When they go to work, there are certain non-negotiables. As they develop a marriage, there are going to be certain non-negotiables. And then as they have children, they're going to have to teach non-negotiables. So for our kids to raise up and be healthy adults, they've got to understand, and this starts in the home, that there are always non-negotiables. So what might those look like in your family? Well, you're going to have to decide that on your own, but I'll throw out some things for you to think about. Safety. Safety is a good non-negotiable. When your kids are little, you may set some rules that, you know, your toddler can't cross the street without holding an adult's hand. Isn't that a good safety non-negotiable? We're not going to sit down and debate that. We're not going to talk about whether, okay, at 2, you couldn't do that, but now that you're 2.5, let's talk about it. Maybe you're ready. No, these things are non-negotiable. Why? Because we love you enough to not let you get squashed like a bug in the middle of the road. You need an adult who can see farther than you can see, who might be able to see things you don't see as a danger to help you walk across the street. You got to wear a helmet. Why? We want to protect that precious little brain of yours and your head and your skull. So there are some things along those lines that you can establish in your home as non-negotiable, even if they seem silly to you. Keep in mind that what you're doing is training them and teaching them that they're going to encounter non-negotiables the rest of their life. You're preparing them for that. Violent behavior, it's a non-negotiable. We're not going to sit around and talk about, because your brother stole your toy, it's okay for you to sock him in the mouth. Not up for debate. It's non-negotiable. It's not okay that you picked up that glass vase and threw it across the room because you were angry. But parents, listen, these are not just non-negotiables for your kids. These are non-negotiables for you. You have to model what you're saying are non-negotiables. How about this one? Respect. Respect is a non-negotiable. Listen, if you want your children to not name call, to not be a bully, to do any of those things, to not lash out at someone else, you can't be doing that to your husband or your wife. Ouch. Because what we do in front of them, they turn around and do when we're not with them. How about this one? Biblical principles as Christ followers. Now, if you're not a follower of Christ, you're kind of off the hook on this one. But those of us that follow Christ, we aren't. We are unctioned by the Word of God to place within our kids biblical principles and to hold them accountable to those things. What are those things? Church attendance. That's a great non-negotiable. Guys, we can negotiate a lot of things. We don't negotiate going to church. We're going to church. You need to be there. You need to establish friendships. You need to hear about God on your level. We're going to church. Being givers. Important thing to establish with your kids. Non-negotiable. We're not just takers, we're givers. How are they going to grow up to be givers in their adult life? How are they going to grow up to think about the needs of others if it's not demonstrated in the home? I love this example. I heard someone the other day talking about, just this Christmas, they were talking about at Christmas or birthdays, if their kids get 5 new toys, non-negotiable in their home is they go, their kids go into their toy closet and they choose 5 other toys that they have and they give them away to somebody else. Isn't that wonderful?
It's awesome.
You're creating a lot of things. You're creating a cleaner closet, getting rid of a lot of mess of stuff they probably don't even use. But the more important thing is you're teaching them that when we're blessed, we are blessed to bless others. We can preach that. We can teach that. You can tell your kids that. You can read a Bible story about that. There is no greater impact than developing non-negotiable ways within your home that they actually see it and learn it by example. And here's the last one that I want to give you, accountability. Talk to your children about accountability is a non-negotiable in our home. So if there's something that we say, we don't do that in this house, we don't bully each other, you're not going to hit your brother or sister, you've got to sit down and set down what the accountability is for that behavior. I just want to let you know, Johnny, that if you punch David because he stole your toy, here's the accountability for that. What is it? Is it, you know, they're gonna go sit in their room for an hour? They're not gonna be able to play on the iPad for the rest of the day? Whatever that is, figure it out, clearly communicate it, and then understand this is not negotiable. Because here's what we do as parents. Okay, so, you know, I'm using the example of, you know, they hit another child. And we kind of look at it some days and go, you know, they've been so good lately. I mean, they've been doing everything we ask. They've been so good lately and so loving, and everything's been going so good. I'm just going to skip it this time. I'm just going to tell them, next time you do that, there's going to be consequences. Listen, when you do that, you're taking away the safe boundaries that you've created for your kids. Believe it or not, as much as they elbow against them and rebel against them and try to walk outside of them, they actually feel safe within the boundaries. Think about it. They were being born, being developed inside boundaries. There was contentment there. That's why when after babies are born, now they encourage us to swaddle them. Wrap them up, tuck their little arms, tuck their little legs in, wrap them up really tight and secure in that blanket. Create boundaries for them because there's safety and comfort and security in those boundaries. Guys, when we just haphazardly decide to change the boundaries on a whim because we feel different that day, we're actually causing some fear and anxiety in our kids because they can't trust that the boundaries are true and that the boundaries stick. Now, will they change as they grow? Yeah. If you're still holding your 15-year-old's hand as they walk across the street, we need to talk.
I shouldn't be doing that with Michael. Oh, just kidding.
I'm helping you today, Michael. I'm helping you. Yeah, so of course we have to sit down and re-talk through those things. New negotiables will be added as they grow older, but non-negotiables are such an important thing in our family life.
Great stuff. All right, so yeah, wasn't that good stuff? Let me tell you a quick story. You know, I did this study one time on eagles, and one of the things I found out about them is when they're in the egg, you know, an eaglet is in the egg, before it cracks out, there are times that scientists have decided we're going to go ahead and crack them out ourselves and see how it affects them. And so they decided we're going to crack them out, got them out. And what they have found out is the eagle becomes one of the weakest of all. And it's all because they didn't break out on their own and they didn't go through the hardship of getting out of that shell. And one of the things I found out as a parent is when our kids were little, because of the kind of lifestyle we lived before Jesus, I wanted to protect them from everything. Yeah. And my next point is don't protect them from hardships. And I don't mean, some kid's beating your kid up at school every single day. I'm not going to protect my kid. I'm not talking about that. But life brings hardships. We're all going through stuff right now. Everyone in this room, we're all looking good. You know, you guys all look really good today, but everyone in here is going through something. Someone's going through a marriage problem. Someone's going through problems with their kids. Here's the deal, guys. If we teach our kids how to get through hardships when they're young and let them see how we worked with them all the way through to, you know, high school, college, whatever, we worked with them. When real life comes, let me just tell you this. When real life comes, how many of us have realized we're all going to go through hardships? And how we got through them when we were younger can make us that much better and stronger as we get older. You know, I don't want to be like that eaglet, you know, that's like, well, I never broke through that. So for me, I have a weakness that I never would have had. I don't want to have that. And so my father, who's watching us today online, and my mom, they let us go through some hardships, and it made us stronger people. For today. And so if you understand this, you will not just look at your kids and say, man, I've got to guard them. I've got to protect them. And instead, help them get through hardships and use God's word to help them get through it. Amen? And then another thing I want to tell you just real quick before we pop back over to Pastor Barb is teach them to win as a team. You know, you think about this, guys. I was a huge Michael Jordan fan when he was playing basketball. I know that's probably a sin in our church with, you know, the Cleveland deal, but I love Cleveland. I love LeBron James. But Michael Jordan, to me, was the best basketball player ever, right? Curry is not the best. So anyway, so Michael Jordan played at Chicago for a couple years where he did not have a team and he played by himself. He scored 60 points sometimes in one game, and they lost. And then they brought some players in. He began playing as a team player, and there were games he only had 20 points, games he only had 30 from 60, but they won. And you know the rest of the story. Teach your kids how to be a team player. You know why? They're going to have a job. And when they have a job, they're going to have to learn how to be a team player. And so you want to teach them that concept for the rest of their lives. Amen? Yeah. Amen. Go ahead.
Okay, so here's our last point, but don't get too excited because we're going to spend a little bit of time on this. But it's this: prepare them for real life. Prepare them for real life. And I really want to encourage you, if you haven't taken notes yet, take a minute and jot these things down because you're going to want to go back to these. How can we really prepare them for real life? Number one, let them develop personal independence. Allow them to develop personal independence. Now, this comes really easy with infants because we actually want them to get some independence. You know, when you have a child, you do everything for them. The first 6 months, it's like there isn't anything that you don't do for them. You do everything for them. So the moment they show a little bit of an ability to hold that bottle on their own, it's like, I mean, you know, we're propping it up under a blanket, you know, doing all these things. We want them to gain a little bit of independence because we want a little bit of our life back, right? So it comes really natural with infants. We go from feeding them things to putting their little Cheerios or their Puffs on the tray and allowing them some independence to develop the skill of using their motor skills to pick up that little tiny Cheerio and find their mouth and get it in their mouth, and to learn once they've got that down not to pick up 50 of them and shove them in their mouths. We want them to learn and gain that independence, but as kids get a little older, we start to feel a little challenged by that. And there's different reasons for it. You know, we get to the toddler age and they want to be a little more independent. They want to open that toy themselves. You know, they want to do a few things themselves. They want to zipper their coat themselves. And it becomes a little harder for us because it requires on our end time and patience.
It's true.
And a lot of times we don't have good time management in our lives. So when the kids are putting their coats on to go out the door, we're already late. We don't have time to stand there and let them figure out how to get the little key thing in the other side and, you know, and pull the zipper up, you know, and I can remember standing there like tapping my foot on the ground, like, can I just get it started for you? And their little independent souls are going, no, I can do it. They want so bad to begin to accomplish something on their own. And we rob them of that when we because of our own neglect, our own busy schedule, we don't put in enough time to say, I'm going to have them get their coat on in enough time so that they have time to fiddle with that thing and become independent and learn and feel good about their accomplishments. We rob them of something with that. And then school age gets a little bit harder. You know, I can remember the first time, you know, they got to walk to class on their own. I had to leave them at the door or outside the door and watch them walk away behind that, you know, the glass door that leads down the hallway that goes to the classroom. And you're thinking, but they don't need me anymore. But I don't want to not be a part of their lives anymore. One of the most hurtful things is when they actually run out of the car without you. It's one thing when they're holding onto your leg crying because they don't want to go. But when they get to the point where they're like, see ya. We have to learn that those steps of independence are building them to being adults and being independent in what they go forward and they do. Another thing at that age, really good, start to teach them things like how to make their own lunch. You know, as a parent, you can feel like, my mom packed my lunch for me every day. When I got up in the morning, she had a hot breakfast sitting there for me, packed my lunch every day, did all those things. Listen, I'm not knocking that, but I am saying at some point, you've got to look at it and say, they've got to learn some of these things on their own. Teach them how to make a sandwich and put it in a baggie. Teach how hard. This is not difficult. Independence is what we want to build with our kids. Number two, let them succeed and fail. We have to allow our children to not only succeed, but we have to let them fail. And part of letting them succeed is taking the time to allow them to zipper their coat. We have to allow them to succeed. I love this example, tying shoes. You know, there was a day when Velcro shoes didn't exist. And as parents, we had no choice. We had to teach our kids to tie their shoes because they were going off to school where their shoes would come untied 10 times a day. They needed to know how to tie their shoes. So we get like this, you know, I'll just buy the Velcro shoes or I'll buy the loafers or I'll buy those cute little boots. I'll do everything to avoid the shoestring shoes. But you're robbing them the ability to succeed and the ability to fail. It's okay for them to cry and get frustrated because they can't tie their shoe. It's allowing the chick to poke through the egg, to experience that hardship, to not give up when times get tough, to not say, I'm not even gonna attempt to do that because I don't think I'm gonna be good at it. I'm not gonna attempt to do that because it's gonna take work and practice for me to get good. And so they go through life so unprepared for adulthood. And we find them quitting jobs and running away from challenges and not experiencing great things in their life because they're intimidated to try it. One of the things that I was most proud about my kids, there have been so many, and it was so hard on us, and we had to risk them failing to allow them to do this. When Stephanie graduated high school in 2002, Michael had graduated in 2000, she graduated in 2002. In September of that year, we sent her off to Singapore for her to go to Bible school. Yikes. Was she prepared for what she was going to encounter there? We sure hoped we had done the right things to prepare her to go. It was a hard thing. We knew they were going to fail at some things. You want to hear a really stupid thing she did while she was there?
Yes.
Really, really stupid. Her and Courtney, her best friend, little Courtney. Courtney Jacobs, who leads worship. They've been best friends forever. Okay, this is a really stupid thing they did. But they weren't afraid to attempt it. Okay, which doesn't really make this point very good. But okay, so they lived in an apartment where there was a key to unlock their bedroom doors. And sometimes the bedroom doors would lock on their own and would close. And so they'd have to go to the landlord and get a new key to be able to unlock that bedroom door. Well, it happened so many times, the landlord got tired of it and told them, if you do it again, I'm going to make you pay. You're going to have to pay to do this. Well, they were on a very, very, very extremely limited budget. We didn't just send them. They needed to learn to be adults. So we gave them a little bit of an allowance. They were on their own the rest of the time they were there. They had to learn. Well, they ran out of money a lot of times way before the month ended. They couldn't afford to pay whatever it paid to get a new key. So here's what these brainiacs did. They went in the other room and opened a window. Were you four stories high? Four stories high. They opened a window and determined they were going to climb on the roof. Or did you go up on the roof? They actually got up on the roof and determined that they were going to tie sheets together into knots. And Stephanie was going to brace herself and hold on to the sheets while Courtney swung down with the sheets into the window.
A lot of movies watched there, right? I mean, it's like, whew.
In Singapore, for a half a world away, this is what these girls are going to do. Thankfully, they didn't do it. And I was so proud that they actually reasoned out that this, a lot of really bad things could happen in the process of this. And they ended up not doing it and had to go get a key. But see, those are the things, parents, are we a little afraid to allow our kids to develop some independence and make some choices on their own? Absolutely. But does it prepare them for adulthood? You bet it does. We need to let them succeed and fail. Let them do their own homework projects. I remember in eighth grade or something, being in biology and having to do an insect collection. I don't know if they still do that, where you had to pin the insects to the board and label them, you know, what they were and what category they fit in and all this stuff. And kids, nobody helped me. And I watched kids coming in with these boards that were like professionally done, because the parents helped them do it. And I went in and had to succeed or fail on my own. Guys, we do too much to help our kids break out of that egg. Those are those hardships that they've got to work through on their own. Number three, support them. Support them in their successes and in their failures. Support them. Get to know what their interests are and take a genuine interest in what they're interested in. Listen to them. The greatest support you will ever give your children is listening. And not being ready with a response. To actually genuinely listen. You might learn something. You might learn something they're going through that you can actually help them with rather than demand their behavior. Support them. Number four, discipline them. If you want your kids to grow up to be healthy adults who don't quit jobs, who don't give up because somebody demands something of them, who holds them accountable, you're going to have to discipline them. And this looks different for toddlers than it does for teens, right? Again, if you're still spanking your 15-year-old, let me just tell you, not a good thing. Talk about demeaning. No. We change our discipline as we go forward, and you need to figure out what that is. Do a lot of reading. Figure that out. There are things we can do, but we've got to, as they grow, allow them to make more decisions on their own. We withhold things from them. That's good. You know, here's part of the punishment. You're not going to be able to have the cell phone. You're not going to be able to go to this movie. You're not going to be able to attend this dance. Those things are really important. But I want to spend just a couple minutes here talking to you about an aspect of discipline as our kids get older that we don't always realize we can do. The root word for discipline is disciple. And one of the definitions of disciple is to teach. It's to teach another's point of view. To teach.
That's good.
And so this becomes an important part of discipline as our children get older. When they get into their preteen and their teenage years, a paddle will not do, in many cases, what a teaching will do. So how do we do that? Here we go. This is going to be really good. Now listen, I got to say this. Children's brains do not fully develop in their frontal lobe until they're in their mid-20s. And in the frontal lobe, here are the things that are still developing in that time frame. The frontal lobe controls judgment, insight, impulse control, and emotional control. Wow. There's a reason why kids through the teenage and high school years and college years don't show a lot of impulse control, binge drinking, all of these things. It's not just because they're bad kids. A lot of times it's their impulse control has not been developed. So we have to guide them through those things. We have to teach and instruct them through those things. So as I go through these points, I want you to understand there are times when they're not going to get it. You're going to be having conversations and you're not going to be able to break through. And you're going to have to override the decision or the choice that they would prefer to make. You're going to have to still be the parent and say, honey, I get it that you don't understand, but this is a safety issue. This is something you'll get it when you're 30. You'll understand it when you're 30. But because you're not getting it now, I have to make this choice for you. There are going to be things like that. I'm not going to talk about those things in the next couple minutes. I'm going to talk about some things where you can allow them to make some choices. Here we go. Number one, talk about options. So if your kid comes to you and says, everybody gets to go out with their friends without their parents there, and I'm the only one that doesn't, talk about some options where you can loosen the reins a little bit there. An option to talk about might be, okay, listen, I'm not going to let you go to somebody's house that I don't know them. They're having a party there. I don't know the parents. I don't know what they're going to allow. I don't even know if the parents are going to be there. I don't know who the other kids are that are going. I'm not going to let you do that, but let's talk about some options. You want a little bit of freedom? You're at an age-appropriate age where I can give you some space. How about a movie? How about if I let you go to a movie with your friends? I'll drop you off. You can buy your ticket. You can go in, spend some time with your friends. You can spend some time at the arcade after the movie's out, and I'll come pick you up at 10 o'clock. Options. Don't just say no. I really want to go to this party because you don't ever let me do things by myself. Don't just say no, you can't go to that party. Say, here's why I'm uncomfortable with the party, but what about this? If the real thing you're looking for is some independence and to be able to do something with your friends on your own, how about this? Talking through options is so important. Can I tell you, we failed miserably in all of these things I'm about to share with you. Miserably. When I say we did a good job when they were little, we failed when they were teens, I'm about to teach you where we failed. Talk through the options. Number two, talk about the pros and cons of what you've decided they can do. Talk about the pros and cons financially, the consequences, future opportunities that they may destroy by making this decision, whether trust could be broken, character issues, other feelings. Talk about those things. Whatever reasons you think are a con to them doing something, tell them those things. Honey, here's why I'm uncomfortable with that. Can I give you an example? Okay, so we've decided to let them go to a movie with their friends. They've decided they want to go to this movie that might have some stuff in it that's a little scary. It's age appropriate, but there's some stuff in there that might be a little bit scary. So here's the cons of that. I'm going to have a conversation and say, okay, let's talk about the pros and cons of you going to see that movie. Pros are going to be easy. They're going to give you a 100 pros for them seeing this movie. You're going to have to help with the cons. One of them might be, okay, I just want you to understand this because I'm going to let you make this decision, but I want you to make a decision with the right knowledge. So I want you to understand this. There's some scary stuff in that movie. And so there's a chance you're going to come home and you're going to be afraid to go to bed without your light on. You're gonna like revert to babyhood a little bit, and you're gonna want your light on when you go to sleep. You're going to be afraid to close your eyes because you're going to see those images in your mind. You might be afraid to go spend the night at a friend's house because of things you saw in that movie. That's a con of going to see that movie. So talk about those things, whatever reservations you have. Honey, this is one of those things that I really think the Bible's kind of clear on, that those aren't good things to put before our eyes. Show them the scripture, talk to them about it, but tell them, I'm going to let you make this decision on your own, but you're going to make it knowing what the consequences could be. And so the kid decides, I know that, I get that, I hear you, I understand it, I want to go. We're like, okay, we're going to allow you to make that choice. That brings us into the next point, which is number four. Talk about a way out for them if things get difficult. Okay, honey, you want to go to this movie? I'm going to let you make that choice. I'm going to let you go. Can I just talk to you about if it gets too difficult? If you're in the movie and it's scaring you so bad you're about to pee your pants, can I give you some ways out? One of the ways is without, you know, you don't have to necessarily do this in front of your friends. If you don't want to be seen, but you could do this pretty easy and they might not notice. And you'll spare yourself visually some of the things that are scaring you so bad. But if what's being said and done and the sound is scary and you close your eyes and that's still not cutting it and you really want to just get out of there, here's a way out. Here's a way out. Spill your pop all over you. eat too much popcorn really fast and say, oh man, I'm starting to not feel good. Guys, I'm gonna go get a ride home. I gotta go. Find a way out. Help them to think about those things. When they get to an age where you let them go to someone's house and they're going to a party and they get there and things are going on that are real peer pressure, but they're embarrassed in front of their friends and they're, give them a way out. Guys, if this happens and you see this, here's a way out for you. Because if we talk through those things with them, we help that part of their brain that might not be able to work through that on their own in that moment, but because of what you talked about in advance, they know a way out. What if they rode with someone to the party and that person got drunk and they have to ride home with them? Are you preparing them for a way out? What's their way out to not get in that car with that individual who's been drinking? Very, very important part of us helping them become adults. And finally, number five, talk about the result of their choice, whether it was a success or a failure. So after they go to the movie, at some point, sit down, have a conversation with them. How was it? Did you like it? Yeah, I really liked it. Was it as scary as we heard it was going to be? Nah, it wasn't bad at all. Did you sleep with your light on last night? No, I didn't. Were you afraid to go to the bathroom by yourself? No, Mom, no, it didn't scare me. I was good. Awesome. That was a good decision then. Did it violate anything in your heart, like as far as God goes and all that? No, it really didn't. It really didn't. Good choice. I'm proud of you. Good job. Also talk about the failure of it. If they made a choice and completely failed, what if they ride home with the kid who got drunk? What if they made the wrong choice and they actually did it? Your response to that is going to determine whether they tell you the truth next time or they lie. So do you still have to deal with things? Might there be consequences? Yes. But what's the tone of your voice? How much negativity? You idiot. How stupid are you? I told you. I gave you a way out. Are you stupid? Now you think I'm going to let you do that again? Listen, guys, the more negativity that we add to that, the less we're training them and teaching them, don't tell her next time. But what if we have a conversation and say, were you scared? Were you afraid to tell me? Did you get tempted to lie? What was it worth it? What all did that create? Let's talk about it. And in a calm voice, be able to say, you know, honey, just because I need you to trust me and I need you to trust that my word is my word. We talked about that if you ever did ride in a car with someone who was drunk and driving, there would be consequences. Remember, accountability. We determined that if that ever happened, you agreed that if that ever happened, the accountability would be that you weren't going to be able to drive or ride with a friend yourself for a week. I got to do it, because if I don't do it, you're not going to trust my word. And you agreed to it, so we're going to hold that accountable. And I know next time you're going to make the right decision. Guys, they're going to be willing to come back and tell you, because they know you've got their best interest at heart. Will they be perfect? No. Will there be things when you're 40, when you're 50, and they've got kids of their own, they tell you things that you're like, don't tell me now. Yeah, those are going to happen. But for the most part, when it matters, you are developing a relationship with your kids of conversation, which is a part of discipline, and you are grooming them for adulthood.
Wow, great stuff, right? Great truth. All right, I'm going to end with one scripture, and then we're going to let you go here just in a moment. I do wish someone would have told me this before I went and saw Jaws when I was a kid. We had a pool in our backyard, and my brothers were all acting like they were sharks that night when we came home and swam. But anyway, Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 6 through 9. Just jot this down as a scripture to go reference, because this shows you how important that some of these truths, we're talking about some of the truths out of the word, watch this. And you must commit yourselves wholeheartedly to these commands that I am giving you today. Listen to this, verse 7. Repeat them again and again to your children. Talk about them when you're at home and when you're on the road. In other words, you're going for a walk with them, when you're going to bed and when they're getting up. Tie them to your hands, wear them on your forehead. In other words, what's he saying here? He's saying, man, everything that we're talking about here, not just this, but everything that you hear from the word, you should be discussing it with your children. Every time you come to church, you take notes. You should go home before they go to bed. Say, hey man, we learned this in church today. Let's talk about it. It's gonna help you be a better parent. This scripture is so important. Our assignment for this week is real simple. What honest conversations do you need to have with either your mate, or if you're a single parent, you know, with someone else, your friend, whoever it might be, if mom, dad, so that you can be better at raising your kids? Guys, listen, this is one shot that we have, and there's a lot of things we regret. We didn't know any better. And I came from a very disciplinary home, you know, where it's like my dad said, this is for nothing, don't start nothing. And, you know, we would smack you across the face or whatever. It's like, hey, I don't know any better. So then you want to pull back completely because you don't want to discipline your kids, or you want to discipline them just like your parents did. And maybe neither are right. There's definitely a middle of the road. So we're hoping that we're helping you, and that you walk out of church and say, man, that really helped me. Even if you got one point out of this today that really is going to help you tweak what you do with your kids, then to me, that's helpful. So I'm going to ask you to do me a favor. We're going to pray for you just real quickly. And I'm going to ask you to close your eyes just for a moment. Just stick with us. We're almost done. I know we went a couple minutes over, but just stick with us just for a moment. Eyes are closed. Father, we pray over every individual in this place today, every individual that is watching us online. We pray for each of them, Father, that you give them wisdom. There's nothing above your wisdom. So if we have wisdom in raising our children, if we have wisdom according to your word with understanding, we're going to do a better job. So I pray over every individual right now for your wisdom, your understanding, and everything we do with raising our children, Father. We want to be better parents, and we thank you for your help in Jesus' name. As eyes are closed, just for a moment.